This is a 2014 Ford Escape with a 1.6-liter turbo. This car came into our shop with coolant leaks. We got some warning lights on the dash, and then when we checked the codes, we got this P2560 engine coolant level low. So we launched a full-on investigation into where the coolant was going. One leak was pretty obvious. It was coming from the thermostat housing on the front of the block. We fixed that one. They did some more testing with this pressure tester. I'll include a link for this tester in the video description. And we found that there was more leaks. You can see here that we had to tear out a lot of stuff to access the location of this leak, which is the three-way hose for the heater core. The coolant was leaking from this push-in fitting, this black fitting, which comes off of the temperature sensor housing and goes into the three-way hose. Here's another close-up where you can see the push-on fitting where it was leaking. So Ford has actually changed the design of this three-way hose, and they've eliminated this push-on fitting or quick disconnect fitting that would have been right here on the original hose. This is the part number for their replacement, and I'll include it in the video description. In the rest of this video, I'll go into a little bit more detail into what we had to do to gain access to this three-way hose, also what we need to do in order to replace it. So keep watching. So to get down here, we started by removing both wipers, then we removed the wiper cowl cover, then we removed the wiper cowl. This is all pretty straightforward, just a few nuts and bolts to turn. And then we removed this air intake tube, we removed the air box with the air filter, we also removed the battery and the battery enclosure. So with all this out of the way, we can get to where the three-way hose fits in to the temperature sensor neck and where it goes to the heater core and also where it hooks into this solenoid. I'm going to try to minimize the amount of coolant spillage. So I've clamped this hose with a locking plier before I disconnected, and then after I disconnected, I'm going to try to feed it into an empty coolant bottle. To disconnect this fitting, I'm using this specialty tool. I'll include a link to it in the video description. You can see on this fitting there's an arrow on the little clip that matches some arrows on the body. This is the locked position. I can fit the tool onto the clip and turn it, and you can see here that the clip has turned away from the markings on the fitting, so it is in the unlocked position and it can be pulled off. So when you use that tool, disconnecting this hose is very simple. It's just a matter of unlocking it and pulling it apart. For this quick connect fitting that goes in the solenoid, I use a small screwdriver to get behind the clip. Then I pry the clip off. This is the locking clip, and be careful. This clip wants nothing more than to just fly away and disappear. Of course, we're replacing it, so it doesn't matter, but in case that you are not replacing it and have to reuse it, you do not want to allow it to fly away. So you can see I've pried it up, and then I also use a small screwdriver in this little gap right here to pry the two pieces apart. I've managed to loosen the clamp on that hose. I could not move it backwards, so I moved it forward. And for the next step, I'm going to use this razor to put some slices in the hose so it'll come off of the coolant neck. So as you can see, by applying the slice, I was able to release the hose from the neck. And all that's left now is, I don't know if you can see it, but there's a little side hose there with a clamp, okay? You see that little side hose with the clamp? All I gotta do is pull that off. So there it is, after all that, this old hose is removed. And right here at this fitting is where it was leaking. So we're just gonna put in the new one and refill and pressure test, and we'll see if the repair was successful or if there are additional leaks to be found. Okay, so I have this end of the three-way hose pushed on. I have this end down here also pushed on all the way. The small hose, I don't know if I can get the camera on it, but the small hose is also pushed on all the way. And this connection here with the solenoid is clipped into place. So all I have to do is to secure the remaining clamps, and then I can put everything back together. Putting it back together, this is the battery box. It has three bolts here, here, and back there. The solenoid screws onto the side of the battery box, onto that boss, with a tiny little Torx head screw. Battery is in. The ECU pops onto the front of the battery box. Connect the positive terminal, tighten it, clamp the battery down, and then connect the negative when that is all done. Next, the filter box is popped into place. Then the intake goes back on and tighten these two clamps. Then the filter goes into the box, and the filter has a groove, has a ridge on the back that fits into a groove in the box, and you just have to sort of wiggle it to get it to fit. Then the filter cover goes on. It also has a ridge in the back, and it has four small screws. Make sure the filter cover keys in nicely into place, then you can tighten the fastening screws. So now, before putting the windshield wiper and windshield wiper tray back on, I can fill the coolant system and pressure test it and actually run the car to check for any more leaks. This is the cowl back on. The brake fluid reservoir attaches right here with two bolts. On either end, you have two bolts that hold this down. Make sure that this cowl cover clips into place securely. It has clips right under the bottom of the glass that must click in and lock in. And then on the front side, it's secured with more metal clips. Make sure you reposition your wipers correctly. You have guides on the glass. I think you can see this one maybe. There it is. Okay, H shape, and the wiper should fit right through that guide on the glass. So test your wipers after you reinstall them, and if you're lucky, you will not have to do the wiper motor recalibration procedure. Haha, whoever heard of such a thing? I mean, that's absolutely ridiculous. Whoever heard of having to recalibrate windshield wipers? This is the most ridiculous thing that any car manufacturer has ever come up with. Trust me on that. Anyway, if you're lucky, you won't have to do it. But if you do, there's other YouTube videos that show you how to do it. We've idled this car repeatedly, checked for leaks, nothing is dripping out. Now we're going to take it out and drive it for a couple of days. The car has been driven for about a week as a daily driver, and we're checking it again. And the coolant level is holding steady, right where it needs to be, so we're pretty confident that the repair was successful. This is after one more week of daily use by our rental customers. So the level is pegged right where it should be. Very reassuring. This is 3 weeks later. Just perfect as can be. And finally, I want to show you some examples of what I call deferred maintenance. And in this case, I'm going to call it undisclosed and intentionally deferred maintenance. So we found paperwork in the glove box of the car from two successive previous owners that they were both advised that they had coolant leaks in the car. And this came from two separate service stations. And looking at the vehicle history in Carfax, all they did following this is they just sold the car to an unsuspecting party. And one of them was even buying coolant to replenish. And when you're buying a car that is gone through multiple owners, you can be sure that there are undisclosed things like this that they know about, but they are not telling you. They will tell you they are selling it because they need a bigger car, or because they're moving, or whatever. Or, you know, adult child has moved away to college and the car is no longer needed. They come up with all these nonsense reasons for why they're selling the car, because they do not want to tell you that the car needs $2,000 of repairs on a $5,000 car. Along with these previous owners, I want to call out the unlicensed, unregistered dealer who sold this car. This is a guy named Tomas Schumacher, who is operating illegally without a dealer license and not paying or collecting any sales tax on the sale of these vehicles that he sells. And he was also most likely well aware of the serious condition of the leak, the coolant leaks, the multiple coolant leaks in this vehicle, but he did not disclose them. Thank you for watching. Hope this video helps you to get your car ready to hit the road again, just like this car is ready for now, until the next thing breaks and it is FORD. Once again, bye for now.